The FBI and the Department of Homeland Security are investigating a Kent State University professor, allegedly for supporting ISIS. 55-year-old Julio Pino, an associate history professor at the school, has not been charged with any crime. The investigation apparently has been underway for a year and a half and is focused on whether he tried to recruit students to ISIS. In an interview, Pino was asked directly if he considers himself a supporter of the terror group, and he said no. He says he's just exercising his freedom of speech.
I'm not under any kind of criminal investigation. I'm not under any kind of suspicion. I haven't been served any papers. So, you know, I'm sure there were stories circulating out there. People may take them with as much of a grain of salt as they want to, but my current status is that I'm a citizen of the United States with all the rights and obligations that entails. I follow the law. I advocate that others do so also. And I ask others to respect my freedom of speech as I respect theirs.
Justice reporter Paula Reed is in our Washington Bureau. Okay, first and foremost, the college campus of any United States of America institution of higher education typically get known for being a safe place for radical views, for pushback against the authority in Washington, D.C., and what have you. In this particular case, what is the professor doing that's raising not only eyebrows, but suspicion?
Sources confirm that there is an investigation going on in the campus, but there are currently no charges pending against Professor Pino. Now, this was first reported by a student news organization that said students were being interviewed as part of an investigation into whether or not Professor Pino was supporting the Islamic State or even recruiting for the terrorist organization. But Contessa, sources tell me that if there was sufficient evidence that he was doing either one of those things, he would be arrested by now. And the university says there's no threat to the campus and they are fully cooperating with this investigation. However, Professor Pino has a long, storied history of saying and doing very controversial things.
You know, it's interesting, though. In 2007, he was a columnist for a pro-terrorism weblog called Global War, reportedly praising the actions of female suicide bombers. His boss, the history department chairman, was fired in 2007 because he had approved a six-week all-expenses-paid trip for Pino to go to the United Arab Emirates to learn Arabic. Apparently hadn't contacted the dean. And then in 2011, there was this widely reported episode on campus where a member of the Israeli parliament came in and he stood up, the professor, Pino, stood up and shouted, "Death to Israel." What actions have the university taken? I mean, it does not reflect well on their campus.
It is quite shocking, especially in this current climate where there seems to be this crackdown almost on free speech and not wanting to offend anyone on a college campus, that someone can say and do so many things that are offensive to so many and still retain their job. But in talking to people at the university, it seems that the line that they're drawing is that he hasn't actually been charged with a crime. The university tells me he's been with the university since 1992. He was given tenure in 1998. And advocates of tenure argue that that should protect those who hold controversial or unpopular views. Now, I also asked the university whether or not they had done anything short of firing him. Has he been disciplined? Has there been any other action taken? And they told me they cannot discuss any sort of private personnel matters, but the university has publicly condemned lots of the things that he says, and they say he does not speak for the university. But again, Contessa, it is incredibly notable that he can continue to say so many things that are offensive, especially when it seems at so many other campuses, people are quick to be kicked off campus or lose their jobs for saying things that are equally or even less offensive than what he has said.
You know, it's interesting, Paula, because we've talked about this before, this fine line between freedom of speech and what raises the hackles of your neighbors who might hear something and say something and get law enforcement involved because you say something that puts fear into people. Is that something that the FBI is grappling with here, the free speech versus recruiting terrorism?
Absolutely. And it's becoming more of an issue because when it comes specifically to the Islamic State, social media is such a part of their strategy. So there's constantly this tension between, you know, will I get arrested for tweeting support for the Islamic State? or for liking something on Facebook. Now, doing that can certainly get you on the radar of federal law enforcement, but there was recently a case in Virginia that I think really draws out the distinction under the law. It is a teenager who's currently serving over a decade in prison for supporting the Islamic State, and many people criticize that case, saying, hey, this is Twitter terrorism. He was just supporting the Islamic State on Twitter. He did. He ran a Twitter account, but that's not all he did. Now, according to the court documents and his plea agreement, he was also tweeting out instructions on how to donate money to the Islamic State and helping other people arrange their travel to go abroad to fight alongside the Islamic State. So that's the distinction. It's one thing to tweet support for jihad. It's another once you cross that line and go into fundraising or facilitating travel. Now, it's not perfect in the material support laws that are used in these cases. They are controversial, but I think that case helps draw out the distinction. You shouldn't and you cannot under the law be arrested or prosecuted just for expressing your support. But once you do something in support, say recruiting for the Islamic State or fundraising, that's the difference under the law.
Paula Reed, thank you.